confused, man.
Hello everybody, Assalamualaikum Sastrikaal, Namaskar to all the listeners. This is Attorney Shapur Ali for the Shapur Ali Law Show, and today I have Michael with me, and later on hopefully we'll be joined with Sharif Silmi, attorney for Washington DC office, and we're going to talk of course about immigration. And before I start anything, I'm going to tell you today is purely educational. You should not act or refrain to act solely on the information provided. You should contact an attorney if you have any questions. And again, this is our 10-year anniversary of the show, so happy anniversary to our show, and it's an honor to be here to serve you and basically to answer your questions. We'll be opening the studio lines in a few minutes for the next 20 minutes, so if you have any call, the number to the studio is 510-657-1170, and if you want to do a consultation, the number to our office, 510-742-5887, 510-742-5887. So to start with, as you know, last week we talked extensively about the F1 visa restrictions. Well, I think they back off now on it, which is great. I know, I think, but they back off. There were 17 lawsuits pending from schools, and they were ready to really kind of sue big times the government, and they decided to back off. So this is good news. As you know, they were trying to pass a law which says students couldn't take online classes on F1, but many schools were unable to really provide a service with the COVID, and it's getting worse, as you know. Unfortunately, even our state now is back to some kind of shelter. So it is important then that this is really major and is good. And the same thing for asylum. It's been held by a judge, which is good news also. The other thing that we know have happened is some embassies now since July 15th have been opening up. So if you have to do a visa stamping, I don't have all the list of the embassies which are open. I don't know if the one in India are going to be open, but I think they are. So if you have to do visa stamping, you can go. But having said that, as much as possible, try not to travel unless you really have to do it, because although you go there, first of all, there will be a lot of delays, and second, with all the restrictions, you might see yourself stuck for one reason or another. So be very careful if you're trying to go for visa stamping. Make sure that you talk to an attorney. You can call us for a consultation or a second opinion at 510-657-1170. 510-657. Well, that's the number to the studio today, but for our office, 510-742-5887, 510-742-5887. The studio lines, like I said, will be open for the next 20 minutes, so feel free to call if you have any questions on immigration, 510-657-1170, 510-657-1170. The website to check is piralilaw.com, and our YouTube channel, youtube.com/sharppiralilaw. Shapur Ali Law, like my name, L-A-W after that. So please make sure that you subscribe to the channel. I try my best to update it, although it's been really hectic lately, and I'm doing only one time update per week, mostly the show, because I have so many things happening that it's hard to really kind of cope with the whole thing. So, and then hopefully Michael will have Sharif joining us in the next 20 minutes, and we will be talking about EB1A, O1 visa, national interest waiver, which is really, really hot right now, because a lot of people are finding themselves not getting permanent job offers, and they need to ultimately get their I-140 approved. If you want to get help on that or an assessment on your EB1, feel free to reach out at our office, 510 7425887. So, like I was mentioning earlier, we had this huge thing, fear, that was caused by the F1 visa restrictions. Many, many students panicked, and I was getting a lot of calls. And now, luckily, it seems like the Trump administration has withdrawn from that. And that, it seems like they come up with a lot of things, but then they cannot really hold it, because luckily we still have a system of checks and balances, unlike, unfortunately, many countries in the world where they don't have this. We still have a system where we can stop them in case we see any abuse and things like that. So I'm very happy to hear that. Now, the other thing, the other news that is kind of worrisome now coming up is that, again, the USCIS seems not to be able to fund itself and is going to be short of money soon. And because of that, they might let go of some staff, or at least give them some kind of what we call leave without pay, or we'll let them go, whichever way they're going to work. This is going to really be affecting the cases. So if you file a case which takes normal times, maybe 2 months, now it might take like 4 months. So be ready for that. And I know a lot of people are upset, and they call us, say, what happened to my case? Why am I not getting an answer? But unfortunately, this is happening for a lot of people because we have a shortage of people. So it is a shortage of people at the USCIS. They don't have enough funding. So I recommend that you talk to an attorney if you need any help. The number to our office, 510-742-5887. And again, like I said, the studio lines are open. If you have any question on immigration, including H-1B, I-140, it is really kind of at your, unfortunately, we are in a situation where everything is getting difficult. I think we have one caller, Michael. Let me take the caller. Operator, you have an air. Hello.
Good afternoon, sir. Thank you for your wonderful service to the community for all these years. God bless you, sir. You've been awesome.
Thank you so much. I really appreciate it, sir. What can I do for you?
I'm every week listener, rare caller, and please no offense. For a couple of weeks, I noticed you are losing your words when you are saying the phone number. You are losing the number. We want you to take care of yourself, sir. Please, we want you to be there forever for us.
Oh, yeah. Thank you so much. Yeah, it happens sometimes. You know, I get very tired, and I do make a mistake on the numbers. I get confused on the two numbers, right? I really apologize for that. So, yeah, good you're bringing that up. Sometimes, you know, you get overwhelmed, and you're so much into the situation, and you see what's happening in immigration. It's overwhelming us, and really, sometimes it gets me messed up on the numbers. Especially, I'm not good in math, so numbers are not my strength, so I apologize for that.
Yes, no apology needed. We just want you to do well. We want you to be well forever. So.
Oh, thank you so much. I really appreciate that. Thank you. Pray for us. Pray for me.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Sure, we will, sir. So my question is, my brother appeared for the green card interview in 2018 March.
Mm-hmm.
So far, the green card has not been issued. And after the green card interview at San Francisco office, the visa officer, along with the deputy, he came to his house and verified that he lived there. And he even went to his workplace and he verified with his manager that he is working. Even after this, it's more than 1 year. So far, the visa officer has not made any decision. So a couple of forums are advising, write a letter to the director of that office, or go to ombudsman, or file a writ petition. So we want your suggestion, making sure that a visa officer doesn't get offended, deny the case.
Okay, that's a very good question. Okay, first of all, what kind of petition was that? Is it an employment base or is it a family base? Is it a
employment base? Employment base.
Employment base. Okay. what I would recommend is that two things. Number one, I don't know how is the company. Is the company in good reputation, or the company is under investigation or something like that? Do you know?
Probably it could be under investigation or something. It's a it's a third party or vendor that offers client location, offer position at client location.
That might be the reason. But one of the things you can do, number one, contact a congressman. You go online, type on Google, find my congressman, and then put your zip code. Have the company do an inquiry for you. But if it is a green card, so he can do an inquiry himself. Talk to a congressman and ask them to find out what's happening. Now, if this doesn't work, yeah, you did that?
Sorry, sir, I apologize to cut you off. So the visa officer came to his house and workplace for inspection with the deputy only after we moved the case with the congressman.
Okay. Then it seems like what's happening, it seems that either the company is under investigation or he's under investigation. Most of the time it's the company, so I will not recommend you discuss that too much on the air. Give me a call at the office, let me know it's you, and then I'll talk to you in details. We can find out exactly we cannot find out exactly, but we can at least do some kind of guesswork where things are. The other option is a writ of mandamus, which I don't recommend in this case, because if they are in an investigation, what will happen, it will trigger more investigation. So this is not... Because the writ of mandamus really pushes them to make a decision. But if they don't have anything against the company, then it's worth it. The problem with the writ of mandamus is that most lawyers who do it, it's costly, and they have to be licensed in that jurisdiction to do that. I used to do a lot of them, but lately I have not been taking them because I've been a little bit busy. But if you give me a call, I can recommend you someone who can actually talk to you, help you on this. But it's not recommended at this point, so I don't want you to discuss that too much on the air. Please give me a call at the office. Just let them know it's you, and then I will talk for a few minutes, maybe 10, 15 minutes, and I can go over things with you. Okay?
Yes, sir. Thank you so very much, sir. Keep doing the service for the community. I appreciate it.
Thank you so much. You're welcome. I hope you have my number, 510-742-5887. This is very interesting what the caller brought up. Sometimes you will see the green card getting delayed because most of the time when we see those kind of situations, this situation is either the company is under investigation or the person is under investigation. And it's usually the company. And that doesn't mean the company did anything wrong. It's just because sometimes they pick companies randomly and investigate them. So you have to be careful. And the two options usually is congressman, and then next is last resort is the writ of mandamus. What the writ of mandamus is, it's a way to push an administrative body to make a decision on the case. That doesn't mean the case has to be approved. All it means is that they will make a decision. So this is where it gets tricky, because whenever you do that now, it triggers more investigation. Unfortunately, because they are defending themselves against a federal court. So you need to be careful before you move to that route. I used to file a lot of them, in fact. I was kind of, our law firm was very well known for filing those, but I've kind of stopped doing them because it's time consuming. Plus, I am kind of already overwhelmed with a lot of work, although I'm able to handle direct immigration cases. But court cases is becoming very bulky, and it's not very convenient for our team to handle those. But I can refer you to someone who handles them. So please give us a call, 510-742-5887. Thank you so much, Ramesh, for your kind words. And it's true, sometimes I do get confused on the phone numbers because my mind is something else. When I'm repeating the phone numbers, I usually get confused, and I apologize for that. So the number to our office is 510-742-5887. The number to the studio is 510-657-1170. So it is important. Yes, Michael, it's true. I'm getting old. Actually, it was my birthday a couple of days ago, so I got old. It's true. We're not getting younger. And with COVID and the stress that is going on, the shelter, and I'm telling you honestly, I'm spending time doing consultation where people are really suffering because many of my consultation are people who are being terminated under H-1B, and what do they do next? Do they stay in America, leave the country, and they are not, it's risky for them to leave. So it takes a toll on me actually when I hear those sad stories, because at the end of the day I'm human. So as much as I try to give solutions, it stays in my head, hey, this is happening to this person and it's so sad, etc., etc. So it is really kind of unfortunately, it is unfortunately that we are in a situation where many, many cases are being, and wrongly also, people are wrongly being advised, unfortunately, sometimes, because you have to look at things in a different angle. You cannot just take the letter of the law. You have to look at the exceptions. You have to look at the other options, because many times people will call me, for example, for an H-1B extension. When I talk to them, they might qualify for an EB-1A. And then sometimes some people are waiting, and I found out that their spouse is born in another country than India, and their waiting time is reduced. So all those things are actually makes a difference. So you need to talk to a lawyer who has experience with all those things, because if you don't, you will find yourself in a situation where you make the wrong decision. For example, I had another person calling me, and he's really confused because he doesn't know if he has to quit his job or stay on the job, etc., etc. And at the end of the day, we find out that this person could have gotten an I-140 approved, but he just lost the chance by leaving the company. So you need to make a decision which looks towards the future. You cannot just make a decision looking at, okay, I'm getting a higher salary, I'm moving to another company. You have to balance things, because what will you do with a higher salary if you're reaching your 6 years, for example, on H-1B, and they have not filed a green card for you? So after like 8 months, 9 months, you're done, you have to leave the country. What do you do next? So you need to make sure whenever you're sticking with a company, look at all the pros and cons. You cannot just look at the salary or the position. So it's very, very important that you make sure, because the company is going to look at their own advantage. And even if you talk to their lawyers, it will be usually to the advantage of the company. So having your own independent lawyer will make a difference. So, Michael, we will call Sharif in a few minutes, and we won't be taking callers, but because once Sharif is on board. So I'm going to talk a little bit about debt settlement, because once I get Sharif, I won't be able to talk about that, because this is becoming big again. A lot of people are calling us because they have to leave the country, they owe money on the credit cards, and they're worried that if they have debts on their head, if they will be able to come back. Usually, yes, but it can influence the... If they pull your credit and they see you owe money, you will be really kind of in a situation where you will have to actually start things of. Well, what I mean is that you are in a situation where you owe money and you have to leave the country, and if you still owe that money and you go for the interview, they find out, it might kind of influence the officer to give you your visa or not. So one way we have been able to help people is to settle those debts, especially on credit cards, other bills, etc., etc. So call us or check our blog, yourdebtsettlementattorney.com, yourdebtsettlementattorney.com. You might be able to actually get all this information. Well, not on the website, but if you call us, we can do at least an assessment. The number is 510-742-5887. 510-742-5887. Excuse me. So the other thing that I wanted to mention is now we don't, the house market is still going strong, which is a good thing, but if in case in some places the house market start getting stagnant or you have a second mortgage and the equity in the house doesn't exceed that, you might get a, we might be able to settle the second mortgages and get you forgiven for most of the amount. We have done that a lot in the past, but now when the market went up, it was kind of difficult to do it. But now since the market is stagnant or the market will go down, we should be able to help you. So give us a call, 510-742-5887. One other thing that people don't know is that if you don't pay your debts, for one, they can come after you in a civil lawsuit. And many times people don't want to spend money to defend themselves, which is kind of useless because at the end of the day, unless you can prove that debt is not yours, you will probably lose in the court. And plus, they will pile up more fees on it. So it is important that you talk to us if you have... It is unfortunately we are in a situation where people are struggling. We are in a in the COVID situation, and it's getting more and more confusing what's happening out there. Wear a mask, not wear a mask, or ultimately what will happen to us, right? What do we do? But at the same time, the money is important. We need to be able to do that. So one of the things we can do actually is get rid, for example, your credit cards, the debts, et cetera, et cetera. So I would highly recommend you give us a call. We can talk about that. So I don't know, Michael, is Sharif already on air? So I'll go ahead and talk until we get hold of Sharif. And the other things we are going to be talking about, we talked about earlier are those rules for student visas where the F1 was getting stuck because many people, there were some restrictions that the Trump administration tried to put, and then they back off the online issue, and many people panic. And in fact, I had a lot of calls, people thinking that, hey, they should leave the country, they cannot stay, and they can't leave because they don't apply, but now we don't have this problem. I think Sharif is there. Sharif, are you there?
Yes, hello, how are you doing?
I'm doing well, I'm doing well. Assalamu alaikum, how are you, Sharif? I hope you're doing well.
Assalam. I'm doing excellent, excellent. Thank you so much.
Good, good. It seems like you're pumped up. So tell us a little bit about some good news. What's going on?
You know, I think that a lot of folks out there, you know, understand that during the height of the shutdown and quarantine phase, the USCIS temporarily suspended the premium processing, and it was then lifted and opened up in early June. You know, since that time, we have filed dozens and dozens of cases that were kind of built up during the quarantine, and we've received such positive, you know, responses. Almost every single case is approved. A couple of them we are, you know, waiting on, you know, the resubmission of certain evidence. But, I mean, we are really, really rocking. I think, you know, it's clearly above 92% of those cases were approved. And I could not be prouder of the team and, you know, the work that is being done there. So I'm really, really excited for the individuals whose lives have really changed as a result of our work and, you know, the sacrifice and time that's spent. So, you know, that's definitely a positive. I think oftentimes people are easily manipulated by news events, you know, watching every update of the news and think that everything is, you know, gone to hell. And, you know, while the news is very good at depressing you, you know, people like us are very good at lifting you up. So that is why, as a matter of philosophy, I always tell people to take matters into their own hands. Whether you decide to pursue an EB-1A, if you're in a backlog, whether you decide to back your I-140 with a national interest waiver, whether you are, you know, perhaps in another country and see that there's an executive order temporarily halting the issuance of visas and it stops you from, you know, wanting to start a business in the U.S., don't let it stop you. Just, you know, make an adjustment. Speak to a qualified attorney that can kind of guide you through the ups and downs of, you know, the immigration process. So, you know, I'm an optimist. I think that's just part of my nature. But ultimately, we need to really focus ourselves on results. You know, that's ultimately what matters the most. It's not about, you know, all the time just focusing or worrying about the negative, but sometimes we have to also focus on the possibilities and opportunities that do exist.
Exactly. So, Sharif, tell us a little bit about, let's cover, we have another, I think, 25 minutes. So let's cover each visa, each the one of them where is your strength, basically. There's National Entrance Waiver, O-1, and also the EB-1A and EB-1B. The EB-1A is the most interesting in National Entrance Waiver because we don't need an employer for that. And tell us a little bit why someone from India will want to have a National Entrance Waiver when it is an EB-2.
Well, I think that the individual that, you know, as everybody knows right now, who is from India and in the United States, there is a country quota system in the U.S. So if you are immigrating from, for example, India and have an employer-sponsored I-140 visa in a professional class, the wait time for that particular I-140 adjustment of status, ability to file adjustment of status will be, you know, 10 years, 12 years, and even if you're more recently approved for an I-140, it could be, you know, dozens of years. So there's not exactly a quick solution there at the moment, and you will undoubtedly move employers. I think the nature of work in the 21st century is such that there will always, it's not like it used to be in the 1960s and 70s where you start a career and then, you know, 40 years you're at the same company. So people are moving around different jobs. So what will happen is if you change your employer, then you're going to have a lot of complication. The new employer is going to have to file a new I-140. It's going to have to go through labor again. You see what is happening with unemployment rate. You don't know what the economic circumstances are going to be. Therefore, what resolves all of these uncertainties and all of these problems for the person who is in an H-1B on an approved I-140 or does not yet or has not yet filed their I-140, if they're in a professional class, is to file a national interest waiver. A national interest waiver will allow you to continuously renew your H-1B, and it is personal to you. So the regardless of the status with the employer, let's say, for example, you're in oil and gas, and you're working for a drilling company as an engineer, and we file, the employer has filed your EB-2, and it's approved, and everything seems fine. Well, guess what happens when the price of oil drops to $10 or $9 a gallon? Your company has gone bankrupt. Your company is going out of business. Your company got bought out by someone, and they decided to lay off half of the staff, and you decided to do a career change or employer change, and you go into a different company, perhaps at a slightly different role. All over again, you're going to have to start from scratch with your I-140 situation. If, however, you're presently at that oil and gas company and we file your national interest waiver and have that national interest waiver approved, when you do your H-1B transfer from your backlog situation, you don't have to ever worry again about your employer filing a new I-140 for you. Is that clear enough, I think, in terms of the reason
why you need
to do this?
Exactly. I think that one of the things that people don't realize, number one, it belongs to you. Number two, you don't need an employer. And number three, you need that to get your H-1B extended. And more companies are having issues to file the EB-2, even EB-3, because they have been laying off people. And when you
that
lay
is
off
the
people,
key point. And I don't think people get that point. I think if you can just enlighten us a little bit, when we are doing a perm EB-2 or EB-3, labor certification and I-140 approval, people, I think there's a perception that it's like guaranteed, and it's not guaranteed.
Yes. Yeah, it's not only not guaranteed. There is a rule which there is a layoff within the last 6 months in that department. They cannot continue the perm or even the I-140. So it's, unless it's already approved, of course. So what is happening, a lot of people are finding themselves, because of the COVID situation, they are all layoffs, there are no way out of this. So what's happening, they are suddenly finding themselves in their company saying, okay, we are willing to file you, we're not terminating you, but since we terminated a bunch of people, we cannot really file your perm right now, your labor certification. And because of that, now you are stuck and you are dependent on that labor certification to get an H-1B extension. And this is where the National Trust Waiver becomes interesting, because there's no perm, it's yours, and it's not dependent on the company. So people should take advantage of that. I had a lot of calls in the recent days where basically people calling me and saying, hey, my company was already started my perm, and then suddenly they had to stop because they laid off like two people, only two. One is good enough to stop the whole thing. So it is important that people know that. And since National Interest Waiver is not based on the company, although the company can file and actually put their names in there, but you don't need that. It is to their advantage to actually look into a National Interest Waiver. And this is the part which I wanted to mention. So Sharif, tell us right now what is going on in terms of how
so can I really quick comment on that before we get into just changes? I just wanted to say
one more thing. Sure, go ahead.
Because I think there's two other scenarios where the National Interest Waiver may come into play. One would be the individual who, again, just speaking in the context of India for a second, the individual who is in the United States on an H-1B without a labor certification and perm I-140 approval. Because, you know, I've heard from a lot of clients now where they are in the fifth year of the H-1B, and now all of a sudden the company, maybe 5.5 years, is saying, okay, you know, we're going to file the perm. Or they're in the fourth or fifth year, they're in the fourth year, and they say, oh yeah, next year, 2021, we're going to do it for you. Well, 2021 is going to come, and the same kind of layoff situation that would prevent somebody already with an approved I-140 from a previous employer is going to prevent you, individual who is in the U.S. on an H-1B, from being able to benefit from that labor certificate and I-140 from the employer. So those of you who are on H-1B working in the U.S. and you're just waiting for your employer to file your I-140, and you're at the mercy of them, you need to take action. Sitting around waiting for your employer to file your EB2 or EB3 I-140 is, at this point, I'm very careful with my words, it is insane. Literally insane. The third category of person who may benefit from a national interest waiver is someone who wants to take an opportunity outside of the U.S. I know that sounds counterintuitive, but let me explain. If you are presently in the U.S., let's say you work in a, you know, technology company, you know, things are going well, you have a good savings, you have maybe a priority date from 2014, 2015, for example, you may be looking right now at a lot of investment in the technology sector that's taking place in other countries. It's taking place in India, it's taking place in Asia, it's taking place all over the world, in Europe, in Canada. And if you have a national interest waiver, then you can easily and very securely take one of those overseas opportunities and maybe work overseas for a couple years and still have the ability to immigrate to the U.S. on a green card when your priority date becomes current. That way you're not just continuously working on the H-1B, you know, staying in the U.S. Without any kind of certainty
Rather, you have your own I-140 personal to you, and you can explore. You can go, you know, spend a couple of years back home. You can do a lot of things that you probably would are maybe waiting on your green card to be able to do. You could potentially do it now just with having a national interest waiver in your possession. So just something to think about. I know that's probably a less, you know, likely situation for most people, but for some people, you know, I think you need to open your mind to think about international opportunities and how a national interest waiver will allow you to keep the priority date and benefits of your immigration status that you've kind of, you know, been holding on to and working for in the U.S. and allow you to take some time overseas, whether it's, you know, some people, maybe their parents are getting older or whatever and they want to be around them. There's a lot of reasons that one may want to, you know, live overseas for a couple of years. So there's something to think about.
Yes, definitely. And this is becoming very, very common. A lot of people seeing, especially what's happening with the COVID situation, family is becoming very important. It's not becoming, but it's been important, but now they are realizing that, and they want to spend time having the national interest waiver in hand. Even you're waiting for the dates, you can wait for it abroad, and when the dates become current, you have two ways to process it. You can either come back here and file the I-45 adjustment of status, or you can process it to the National Visa Center and to the U.S. Consulate, which means you come directly on a green card. So this is very, very interesting, Sharif. And let's talk, let's move on to EB1A, because that's another interesting one, because we are seeing the dates jumping. And I think it is very interesting, very attractive for people to get EB1A. Today one client called and he said, I don't know how to tell you, but everybody I talked to told me I couldn't get an O1, but you guys did it. I still don't know how you did it, but I'm very happy you did it. So let's talk about EB1 and then we'll move to O1. And since you came late today, I'm not saying you're late, but I'm saying that we took you late. We will have to kind of cover everything in the next 12, 13 minutes. So let's cover EB1, sure. And then we'll talk about O1. Go ahead.
Yeah. Again, I think EB1, where we need to get out of the frame of mind that you need publications and you need a PhD to file EB1A. That has been completely repudiated by data and our track record of success, you know, filing these cases. So, you know, I think that, I would point to the most important factors with relation to EB1A would be that an individual commands a high salary. I think if you are in a salary range that is, you know, around 200,000 or above, if you are maybe in California, and 150,000 for most other states, then you are really looking at a very potential strong case, because you have to understand that while you and your cohort and your friends, you know, who, you know, may be making that kind of money, it is not the norm. It is an extraordinary circumstance in the United States in 2020 to be making over $200,000 per year. It's a very small sliver of the population that earns that kind of income in a professional, 40-hour job. So I think that we, you know, really need to emphasize the importance. Why do I always mention salary? It's because salary is an objective measure of recognition in the field. So, for example, if you are an individual who works in a software sector, and you have risen to a very high level, you know, say at one of the major technology companies, you're likely between, you know, salary and stock guarantees and bonuses and the like. I mean, you might be over 400,000, 450,000, and you think that's normal. It's not normal. I promise you it's not normal. And this is a very, very important way to determine whether one is able to file for an EB1A case, because like I mentioned, it's objective, right? There, you can't fake your salary. It's either salary or you don't have a salary. I think too often people in the EB1A context think that they need publications and they need a PhD and they need letters of support. I honestly have observed through
the process, that's not really the case. That's not really accurate. When you look at the statutory requirements, when you look at the appeal decisions, when you look at all of the factors, it's about being reasonable, logical, and persuasive. I would say that is a very important term, is that you present a persuasive case, a credible and persuasive case. That's what you need to do if you want to get an EB1A approved. It's, there's no way to, like, think, oh, you know, so-and-so got denied, therefore I can never be approved. Maybe so-and-so failed to provide the proper evidence. Maybe so-and-so failed to, you know, have a persuasive argument. Maybe all they did was rely on, you know, some publication that was put into an obscure journal that nobody reads or cites 3 months before their case was submitted. And the officer rightly recognized that this is just, you know, not credible evidence and denied the case. It does not mean that you will not qualify just because your friend who thinks they know everything failed. So I would advise people to invest in proper advice and not rely on forums, you know, only rely on forums and not only rely on your friends or so-called friends, I should say.
Yeah, that's a big problem because I know a lot of people rely on those forums or they talk to attorneys who are still looking at the EB1 on the conservative side, quote-unquote, while we're taking a different... Well, it's not the different approach. This is the right approach, but we have been able to really kind of synchronize that in the best way for the benefit of the client. So that's why we are seeing a lot of cases where the lawyer is telling them it's not possible getting approved, and that's we have a lot of the situations. So I highly recommend you give us a call if you need help, 510-742-5887. We'll be glad to look into your case and do an assessment for you. And Sharif, we have another 10 minutes to go. So anything on EB1A that you would like to mention? If because a lot of people, they get scared of filing the EB1. For one, they think it will affect their present perm case. And that's not really the case. In fact, we can use a priority date from your previous I-140 and put it here. And plus, if your company is filing a perm, a labor certification for you, don't worry about it. Let them continue that because it's good to have it. And let us do our EB1 thing here without them even knowing because they don't have to know anything, in fact, on EB1A. It's none of their quote-unquote business. So it is important for people to realize that because EB1A is going to give you a door to... ultimately, I don't want to say heaven, but it is going to take you really to a good path. So take a chance. Give us a call, 510-742-5887. And if it is not possible, we'll tell you up front. Sometimes we're still debating cases, Sharif, right? I will think it's a good case. You'll tell me, no, it's not a good case. Or vice versa. So that's how we brainstorm on those cases. So you're getting two brains, three brains sometimes in one, so take advantage of it. Sharif, since we have another 10 minutes, one of the things I would like to discuss is a lot of people see EB1A as this unreachable goal, right? Because like you said, they think they have been hearing publication. No, it's not. And can you give us some example of cases, well, without giving any confidentiality, where people had no publication, we still got an approval?
Yeah, I think that, you know, one popular area for my, you know, cases that have been approved is surprisingly to a lot of people, not surprisingly to us, is people who work in, I would say two categories. One is, I like to call it, it's traditionally called DBA or database administrators. I like to call it database optimization and security experts. Because if you look at the job of a DBA, ultimately, what are they really trying to do? They are trying to take legacy systems that are vulnerable and move them into, you know, like the latest technological, data management systems.
systems. So essentially what that is doing is optimizing the access to data and providing it with a better security infrastructure. So, you know, again, this is what persuasive language is. I am a DBA. No, you're not a DBA. You're a database optimization and security expert. There's a big difference if you submit an EB1A case as a database administrator or as a database optimization and security expert. It's night and day. So, I mean, you know, you need somebody that can have that kind of vision and to really open up what your possibilities are. So those folks, I think, are being successful because there is tangible work product evidence that we can point to that demonstrates that they have made significant contributions. Where, for example, one has implemented a completely new data management system, and that is a tangible thing that we can point to, that is really important evidence. And then the other thing that we need to realize about data is data is the most valuable commodity in the world right now. It's more valuable than platinum. It's more valuable than, you know, everything, gold, whatever you can call it. So this is a really, really important area. But ultimately, whatever area you're working in, whatever endeavor that you're involved in, it is about persuasively presenting your area of endeavor, right? I mean, for example, you may be, scenario is where someone is working in software design and software application design. So, you know, they may be working software application design, but their particular focus might be something related to, for example, you know, helping people who, you know, are maybe have, let's say, the elderly, right? Like, you know, providing application software design that allows individuals above maybe 70 years old to be able to use it. Or let's say it focuses on people with Parkinson's. I mean, there's so many reasons why one may have a very specialty area of endeavor. You just need to uncover it. One that I could think of also that is, you know, more and more you know, becoming popular these days is the idea of providing healthcare services. And I'm not just talking about your, you know, regular general practitioner doctor, but for example, you know, providing the delivery of, you know, ability to order or find pharmaceutical you know, solutions through an application, and it's still secure, it meets all the you know, compliance requirements. So, you know, those are the kind of things that we like to focus on. There's been a wide variety of cases that we're seeing approved, not just the traditional kind of research and development of, you know, highly advanced, which we get a lot of those. I mean, don't get me wrong. I mean, for example, people who are doing, you know, things related to wafer technology, or people doing things, you know, that are in the semiconductor arena. So, you know, it's really technology, biotech, semiconductor, healthcare. All of these areas have potential for EB1A, but the question is, where do you stand within that field? And how can we persuasively articulate the work that you are doing? Ultimately, that is the question.
So this is the situation right now. It's very interesting because a lot of people don't see themselves. So we have another 2 minutes to go, Sharif. So can we just quickly talk about O-1 visa, because that's another option, alternative to H-1B. A lot of people don't know that O-1 doesn't even carry that mandatory salary that you have on H-1B, so it's a good option if someone is qualified for that. Tell us quickly about that, and you have 2 minutes to do that.
Yeah, so let me just give you an example of a recent, you know, situation. So, you know, we had a case where an individual is very, very talented. He's being paid very well by a very up-and-coming high-tech company that's doing really, really well. And this company said, look, you know, our company attorney is saying that the OPT of this individual is ending. They need to go back to their country and then try to bring them back. And this person was really, really in a back to the corner, did not know what to do, could not leave the country, did not want to leave the country, was going to leave the job and go back to school. And then we presented the O1A plan where, you know, and it was completely rejected by the company attorneys, by the way, where they said there's no way he can get approved, there's no way it's going to work, et cetera, et cetera. He doesn't have publications, he doesn't have a PhD. And lo and behold, we obviously, you know, did our work, presented it in a persuasive way, highlighted the salary, highlighted the critical role he performed, highlighted the original contributions of major significance to the field of endeavor, the reviewing and judging the work of others, membership in professional organizations. And, you know, it was very successful, like it is in many, many cases. So, again, you know, the O1A is much easier to get approved than EB1A, and it's also a really good stepping stone for somebody who maybe is an OPT or maybe they're having trouble with the H-1B and then wants to get into a potential EB1A situation. And the drawback of the O1A, if you want to know the truth, is that you don't get the spouse to have the work permit. So that's a little bit of a drawback. But ultimately, it's, you know, a great step if, you know, you want to have ability to work and live in the U.S. while, you know, continuing legal status and you're not able to get an H-1B.
Yes, exactly. So we have no more time to go now, Sharif. I wanted to thank you so much for being here. Hopefully we'll do another show in a couple of weeks. So thank you so much. And for those who need help, 510-742-5887. I wanted to thank all the listeners. This is our 10th year anniversary of the show, and I really want to thank you, especially all the people who have been listening to us for 10 years. And many people don't get bored about it. That's the good news. And of course, we are able to help as many people as we can. And we wanted to thank all the listeners, thank Michael, thank the Radio Zindagi, and all the people who have helped us in those 10 years. And anything we told you today is our opinion. You should not act or refrain to act solely on the information provided. You should contact an attorney. So I think Michael, thank you so much. And we'll be back next week, same time, 10 a.m. Please tune in and check our YouTube channel for the podcast of the show. YouTube.com/Shah Pirali Law. Thank you. Take care. Bye-bye.